asked you about her age, her height, her occupation, and you filled out the form, which we're going to feed into our mating matrix computer. Now, we can't guarantee that we're going to get it spot on, but I'm telling you that there is information on here that matches up to at least two women in our studio audience. Okay? So let's go to the computer. And we put it in. And we press a button.
Hey. Your name is?
Lena.
Angie, we have Lena.
Yeah!
And here is our second lady.
What's your name?
Dolores from Harrow.
Let's hear it for our ladies.
This one. I saw me like it.
Is it, Jim?
You're lucky to say, you know, I'm up against you, you know. Boy. My girl, them, this, you know.
Jeffrey. Thank you, Jeffrey.
What's going on?
Mark is going to take Dolores and Lena on the first of the three road tests, which is dress to impress. Welcome to the first of our three road tests, which is Dress to Impress. As you can see, we're at the beach party. Just before we get going, I want to ask Dolores a few questions about herself. Dolores, what area of London are you from?
I'm from West London.
West London. And tell me, what's your ideal man, Dolores? What does he have to possess?
Intelligence.
Yes.
And a good sense of humour.
What about looks-wise?
Not important, from inside.
It's got to be from inside.
Yes.
Didn't I hear somewhere that you like a mix between Will Smith and Denzel Washington?
Perfect. That's because with Denzel Washington, he's a more like a family, you know, man, and he's very intelligent. With Will Smith, the part he plays, actually, he's very bubbly, nice personality, and I like a man to make me laugh.
Okay. But would you say that Mark is a mix between Will Smith and Denzel Washington?
Oh, yeah.
You say no. Dolores says yes. Dolores, you have 60 seconds. We call it the golden minute. You're going to go off, get into your beachwear, come back and impress Mark with your lyrics. Take it away.
Any man that can take me out of my beach water, you know. And when I look across and I see you, I said, who is that good, nice-looking babes across there? I had to get out of the water and look at you. So what are you saying, babe? Are you going to be my tiger tonight?
I think you better go back in the water and cool down.
Dolores,
well done. Are you ready, Lena, to take this man on?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Are you ready?
More than ready.
Let's get it on, babe.
And let's get it on.
There's some tigers and tigresses tonight. So, Lena, tell me what area of London you actually come from.
Northwest London, Harrow.
Northwest London in Harrow. And what do you do for a living?
I'm a housing officer.
You're a... She's a housing officer. Tell me about your ideal man.
He's got to be unpredictable, energetic. Hey, baby, I'm full of spice.
Does Mark fit the description, Lena?
Well, we're going to test it out right now. I want to get down.
Not too far, though. Not too far.
I'm going to get out of the way. Lena! You have 60 seconds to go. Change into your beachwear and come back and impress Mark with your lyrics. And your 60 seconds start now.
Do you like in a woman?
Well, with that shake, have you got any burgers?
Baby, I wanna get it on with you. I think we can make it together.
Situation, please.
Hey, boy.
I
hope you drink Guinness.
Mark, Mark's out of 10 for the Dolores, please.
I give Dolores 7.
Dolores gets 7. And what about Lena?
I give her 9.
Lena! End of our first road test. We're now going to move on to the bump and grind. Lord help us. Lord help us. Jeff! Jeff!
Oh, Billy, mate. Billy the geezer.
The shirt. Where did you get the shirt?
Your mum sold it
to
me.
Oh, my God.
Come on, Tottenham, I want it!
Can you please give me a burst of what you're going to be playing in your nightclub tonight?
All right, mate, I know what you people like. Here, have a little touch of this one, eh?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Explode, yes. Give me the explode. Put them on the pressure when you're done, yeah. Now, need explode, yeah. I'm set on for sale. Because you know you're going to come concrete. Explode, yeah. Life down the mic to your back.
Ready, ready, ready.
Can we have our first lady out, Dolores, please?
Go on, Dolores, love, show them a score, mate, and all that, you know what I mean? Go on, man, keep it looking
good. Dolores, you look ready. Jeff, does she or does she not look ready?
She looks like a bit of salt to me, you know what I mean? Oh, yeah. All right,
Mark,
darling.
Are you ready? Most of all, Billy, are you ready?
All right, mate, if you get luck, give me a bit of space to get sorted. You've got 60 seconds starting.
You okay, Mark?
I'll tell you what, Edge, I do love how you people move. You know what I mean?
Well, I think we should move on to contestant number two, yes. Thank you, Dolores. Wait, come here, Dolores, please. Over there, over Lena.
Hi.
Are you ready?
Of course I'm ready.
Mark, are you ready? Billy, are you ready?
I'm always ready. I'm always. Come on, Tommy. Go, mate, give it all, day,
and after that session, Mark, are you ready to give your scores?
Yeah.
Okay, how are we scoring for Dolores?
I give Dolores a number 9.
Dolores gets 9! And Mark, how are you scoring for Lena?
I give Lena a number 8.
Lena gets 8! Okay, now I have to ask you, Mark, what is the reason behind your scoring? Why 9 for Dolores, why 8 for Lena?
Because I just leaned back and Dolores just took control.
So you like a woman that takes control?
Oh, yeah.
Would you agree, ladies?
Yes!
Okay, so, Jeff, what are our scores so far?
Scores so far? Dolores has got a delightful looking 16 and Lena's way in front by 1 point on 70!
Thank you, Jay. Just love that shirt. Okay, well, that's round 2 over and done with. We now move on. Now, this is going to be very, very interesting. Mark, Dolores and Lena are going to romance and dine. Well, we've had 2 very, very steamy rounds this evening with Mark and Dolores and Lena. Would you agree? Yeah? Very steamy indeed. What do you think about it, Jeff?
Well, I'm praying for it.
Now, this is my favourite part of the show, the romance and dine. Now, normally it's romantic and quiet and very, very civilised, but who knows with Mark, Dolores and Lena. OK, Mark has got some moral dilemmas for you, OK, Dolores, because we want to know how well you've got to know him. He's going to give you 3 moral dilemmas. There are 5 points per dilemma if you get it correct. So, Mark, take it away.
OK. I accidentally let my 5-year-old sister's hamster out of its cage. It is lost forever. What do I do? Do I A, replace it, then explain that it's natural for a hamster to change colour? B, come clean. You shouldn't lie to a lady whatever her age. Or C, deny all knowledge and let her look for it.
I think I'll go for B.
He said B. Well done, Dolores. 1 down, 2 to go.
Now, if I was offered £500 a day not to touch my lover, would I A, find it absolutely impossible, I always have irresistible partners, B, torture myself for a few days, then whisk my partner off to the Caribbean for a touchy fortnight? Or C, get my thrills from spending money?
I think I'll go for B.
He said B. Well done, Dolores. He said B. 3rd and final question.
Right. I have a surname that encourages laughter and ridicule. Do I A, change it to something more sophisticated? B, keep the name but deny it to attractive women? Or C, be proud of it? I'll be remembered.
You seem like a very bubbly sort of person, so I think I'll go for C.
He said C! He said C! He said C!
And what is your surname?
Mahoney.
Mahoney is his surname! Mahoney!
Mahoney! Jeff, how much has Dolores scored?
15!
Well, I think we can safely say that Dolores knows Mark, yeah?
Yeah.
I think so. 3 out of 3. Well done, Dolores. Now it is time to bring in Lena. Oh, boy. And Lena looks ready. Well, Lena, we saw you on the dance floor. We've also seen you on the beach and on Mark on the deck chair, OK? What we now want to know is, have you actually taken note of Mark and what's going on in between his ears? There are 3 moral dilemmas, and it's 5 points per dilemma should you get them correct. So, Mark,
okay.
Deal with Lena.
Now, my gorgeous ex-lover asks me if I fancy a one-night stand. I have a new lover. Do I, A, jump at the chance, B, refuse what is the past, or C, suggest a threesome?
Well, as you know, nothing is sweet the second time round, so I'll go for B.
He said B! He said B!
Well done. Question number 2.
Okay. I see an unarmed policeman in difficulty trying to arrest an unarmed man. Do I, A, ignore and continue on my way, B, get out my camcorder and start filming, or C, help the man to escape?
Excuse me, after recent events these days, you can't really trust the law, so I'll go for B.
He said B! He said B!
Mark.
Okay, I'm on a train and I try to reserve the seat next to me, hoping that attractive lady I see queuing will sit there. But an old lady sit next to me. A, do I let her take the seat? I like older women. B, make a signal to her, it's now or never. Or C, tell her that it's my mum's seat.
C.
He said C. You know this man very, very well.
Jeff, at the end of that, how much did Lena score?
Lena lied to her teeth and got 50!
Lena! And Mark, well, the heat is on, the heat is on. Can we have Dolores back on stage, please? Well, it's been an incredibly heated evening. I think that Dolores and Lena have put Mark through the treadmill physically, but they also knew him very well mentally. Now, before we move on, Jeff, we need our final scores, please.
Angie.
Yes.
Unbelievably, Dolores has scored a tremendous 31. But Lena has just pipped her with a tremendous 32!
Oh, Mark, there is 1 point in it. There is 1 point in it. They were very, very close in all areas, weren't they?
Yes.
In all areas. Yes. But, Mark, do we have a surprise this evening for you?
Me? Angie, whilst all this has been going on tonight, Mark's elder sister Kim has been casting a family eye over the proceedings. And Kim, you can make or break this. Now, Kim, I'd like you to award the 2 women on stage individually, marks out of 10, and tell us which one you think Mark should go for. So, marks out of 10 for Dolores.
Dolores, I'll give 9.
9 to Dolores. Excellent.
9.
Whoa! And how many would you give to Lena?
I'll give Lena 10.
Lena gets the maximum!
So
why did you choose those marks for Dolores and Lena? Quick, then go.
Dolores is fine, but Lena, he's met his match.
He's met his match, AJ.
He's met his match. He's met his match. Would you agree with that, Jeff?
Well, maybe, but I'm just talking to the sister, so I don't really care. What are you doing tonight later? Anyway, over to you, AJ.
Thank you, Jeff. Mark, Big Sis gives Dolores an extra 9, but she's given Lena an extra 10. So, Jeff, what does that make the final scores?
AJ, Dolores has a funky 40. And our winner this evening with an even funkier 42 is Lena!
Lena! Well,
commiserations to Dolores, but Jeff has something for you.
Don't feel too bad, Dolores.
I am not, because look what he missed.
Yeah. Don't worry, I'll tell him about it. We got a goodie bag here, Dolores, with the usual sort of stuff to get it on, T-shirt, the cap, whatever. And hopefully, I'll see you soon. You never know what's in it. The cheap or expensive, it's our very own goodie bag with its incredible range of prizes.
Thank you, Dolores!
So, Mark, you could be on your way to Mauritius with Lena. However, if you're not quite satisfied, you can play the Joker of the pack, yeah? What we'll do, we'll put your information back into the mating matrix computer, and it'll be a choice between a completely blind date or Lena. Now, what's it gonna be? Is it gonna be the blind date, or is it gonna be Lena? Look at his eyes, look at his eyes. Think about it, Mark, think about it, Mark. Is it gonna be a completely blind date or Lena?
I'll go for Lena.
He's gonna take Lena! Congratulations to Mark, congratulations to Lena. They could find themselves going on an all-expenses-paid holiday to Mauritius. But in the meantime, we're going to send them out for a beautiful Caribbean meal for two, where they'll be catered by Chef Orlando. So until next week, we say...
Wait.
Oh, boy.
It was hot in here tonight?
I'm telling you.
Okay, go on.
Okay.
Say it.
Until next week.
Say it.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.
If you'd like to take part in Get It On, either as a member of the studio audience or perhaps a contestant, then you can write to Real Deal Pictures, 112 A and B Westbourne Grove, Chepstow Road, London W25RU. Or you can call 0171 229 1213.
You are now watching the A-Force on BBC Two.
Oh, yes, all right, then, yes. Oh, yes, 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 all right. Yes, yes, yes. All right. Oh, God, oh, get out of the car. Get out of the car. Come on.
Hey.
Get out of the car. Come on, get out. Listen to me. You have it all wrong. You got the wrong idea there. You see, listen to me, look. That young lady there, right, she... Is that what you think, you see? She's a nun, you know? I mean, well she's a police inspector. Well, she's my sister. No, I don't mean that she's my sister. I mean, she's a sister. And we was having some discussions about, you know, some things relating to her problems that she was having. As you know, that we are all brothers and sisters anyway. Brothers and sisters.
Fortunate that Jonathan and Lester missed the service, but the funeral is not over yet. I know that neither of my boys will let me down.
Fly away.
How can I be glad that I missed my own dad's funeral because I was watching some machine try to keep a man alive? A man who was nearly killed because of me. How can I be glad that I can't as much as step out of my own house without a bunch of kids trying to rip the shitting bollocks off me in revenge?
Ashes.
I don't know why you had a need to miss your father's funeral service. And I don't want to hear your excuses either. You are the one who's got to live with your conscience, and only you can answer to it.
Marriage!
Come on, Aquila.
Don't come near me.
Look, will you just calm down?
Calm down?
Dad was moved, Marty. He had a heart attack. Them kids, they never killed him.
So what, Aquila? You're just gonna stay there and dry up? No man in your life? No family, no nothing?
You're assuming I have no man.
Mr. James Peters, I have a warrant for your arrest on suspicion of the attempted murder of James Murphy. Morning, Lester. Fancy a chat?
Not really. Got some previous appointments.
Well, life's a bitch, then you marry one. On your feet.
Lester Peters and his sister. Look, we've been down there most of the night trying to see him, but the desk sergeant told us we had to go. Yeah, but we just want to know how he is. Can we see him yet?
Morning.
Hello.
I wasn't expecting anybody.
Sorry, Mum, I asked them yesterday. I should have told you.
We've come to give moral support.
You need comforting, things being the way they are.
Oh, thank you, sister. What is this, Pearl?
Oh, lamb stew and a couple of other things. We're not having you cooking. Put your feet up.
Never mind the food, sister.
Yes, comfort.
What's happening with Lester?
We've been down at the station. They still won't let us see him. I think they're giving us the runaround.
You should have waited. It was my dad's funeral.
We knew you'd be there.
Great bit of detective work.
There's a lot more to come yet.
Oh. And I suppose you're going to get the white guys who attacked my dad, are you?
There's no witnesses to that one, Lester.
And who are your witnesses to me supposedly sticking Murphy?
We knew you were there and you had one hell of a motive.
Bollocks. You haven't got any witnesses or you would have charged me.
Lester. Who was there with you?
You're bullshitting. You ain't got nothing, have you?
Your arse is on the line. You better wise up and get yourself a solicitor.
No! I told you! I don't need one! I haven't done anything!
Sister Rose,
why can't we see him?
Thank you for coming, sisters. If you go through, Sister Pearl will get you a drink.
I suppose it's Lester she's talking about.
Oh, yes.
And thank you very much for nothing!
What did they say?
We still can't see him.
Why?
I'm going back down there.
Aquila!
We can't stay here, Mum, and do nothing.
Well, there's no point you going.
I don't care. It's what I want to do.
Well, Jonathan!
Hi, Mum. Oh.
The Wanderer returns.
Hello, Aquila.
Jonathan, that can't be you.
I think it is.
Aquila, wait! Jonathan, talk to her.
I can handle this on my own, Mum. I'm used to it.
Well, someone like to tell me what's happening?
It's your brother, Lester.
He's been arrested.
We'll sort it out, ladies. You ladies go through and make yourselves at home.
What's he done now?
Oh, we can see whose side you're on.
But will you stop bitching and tell me what's going on?
Someone stabbed one of the Murphys.
Lester?
No. The police have held him all night.
So I'm going down there to see what's happening.
Hold on.
Jonathan! He's been accused of attempted murder of a white man. If Lester loses his temper at the station, who knows what they'll do to him.
All right. When did you last speak to the police?
Just before you came home.
Give us a number.
We've done all that.
I want to speak to them.
You're wasting your time.
Give the number to your brother.
If Murphy dies, you're on a mandatory life sentence.
No one will convict me on the crap you supposedly got, right?
Vicar's son murders defenseless old man.
I ain't hearing you. And my dad wasn't a vicar.
Getting well with your dad, did you?
Yeah.
You see, it all points to you, Lester. And you've got a brilliant motive. Revenge.
Yeah, but I'm not stupid, am I?
I'd have to blame your mind. If I thought someone had had something to do with my old man's death, I'd want to kill someone.
But I'm not you.
Come on, Lester. Who was with you? Five black faces and you knew them.
I don't know, mate. Seen one black face, seen them all, ain't you?
Stop pissing me about, Lester. Five of you stood around the defenseless old man and you stuck a knife in him, didn't you?
Didn't you?
No! How many more times? No!
You stay here 5 minutes, then it's back to yours, yeah?
Oh, I wonder what we'll do there.
Oh, well, practice makes perfect.
Well, you're a long way from perfection.
What's that supposed to mean?
Hello, Sister Peters.
Let's be fair, Darren.
Oh!
Thanks. Well?
Still questioning him.
But that's all night. Can they do that?
They can do what the hell they want.
They can't hold him much longer without charging him.
What about a solicitor?
He's still refusing one.
What?
He thought it'd all be cleared up in half an hour.
But he must have a solicitor.
Is that, barrister woman? What's her name?
Hazel Charles.
Yeah.
She's around.
Well, I'll get him to wear her, shall I?
Big bro comes home and saves the day, eh?
I'm trying, sis.
Yeah, aren't you?
It's too long since I saw you, Jonathan.
Sorry I missed the funeral, Mum, I really am.
No flights back from Cape Town?
No, not directly. It was a cheap airline ticket. They could only get me home through Amsterdam. It was a bit of a nightmare, actually.
I wanted you here, needed you.
Oh, I'm all screwed up. I mean, I know I messed up, but I'm here now, eh? I'll go down to the cemetery and pay my respects at the grave tomorrow.
I wish you'd known your dad properly.
I want you to.
He loved you, Jonathan. But you were a disappointment to him.
I loved him too, Mum. But he would never let me in.
I never understood you two.
Mum, shall I take care of the food?
Oh, please.
You should go through and have a sit down.
I will. Will you bring me a drink, darling?
Sure. You should be looking after her, Jonathan.
I thought she was okay.
Well, if you were here more often, you'd know when she was okay and when she wasn't.
Jonathan.
Not right now, ladies.
What's wrong with that Peter's boy? Aquila! Oh. How's your mother bearing up?
Sometimes she's okay, and other times she just spends time at church and breaks down crying.
It's early days yet, and all this business about Lester doesn't help, does it?
No, it's the last thing she needed.
At least Jonathan is back home now. A real surprise for you, I bet.
A real surprise.
Tell me, when last did you see him?
Years ago, I can't remember how many exactly.
Well, you take good care of your mother, Aquila. She was good to Ruth and me when we first came to England.
Yes.
Do your duty as a daughter.
Of course.
You're coming in.
Why? What can't you handle?
Mum could do with rescuing from Sister Gittins. It's just getting into a chat on embalming.
What is she like?
I'll give Hazel a call.
So, you okay?
Oh, yeah. You?
Great. I always knew you'd turn out to be a handsome thing. Do you remember when you burst in on me taking a bath in your house?
Oh, yeah. How could I forget? I was 15.
I was never quite sure whether you did it on purpose. Well, did you?
That would be telling.
Right, we'll be off then, Dad.
You just got here?
I've got things to do.
Like what?
We were going to go down to the library, do a bit of study, weren't we?
Never mind that stuff. You stay and enjoy Sister Peter's hospitality. And anyway, I want to have a word with Latifa about the choir.
There's no way I'll be here longer than 5 minutes.
Oh, you know what he's like.
I know what they're all like, Darren. It's boring. There's got to be something better than this.
I didn't expect Jonathan, seeing as he missed the funeral.
He was doing his best to get back from South Africa.
Oh, holiday or work?
Work.
I think.
Has he taken all this trouble with Lester?
Oh, same as everybody else. The police had no business arresting a boy at his father's funeral. I'm still so angry, as most of the church are.
Of course, Elder Gittins and I were shocked. Still, I suppose, there's a black sheep in every family. But having Jonathan home must be so comforting.
It is.
After all this time. Is he going to stay?
Oh, yes. That's what his dad would have wanted. There's a church leadership to consider.
Oh, yes. It'll need someone of good standing.
Exactly. That's why Jonathan is perfect.
If you had nothing to do with it, what's the story about going to the hospital to see Murphy? Didn't think I'd come up with that little gem, did you? Another great piece of detective work.
It doesn't prove anything.
No, but it builds me a picture, you see. The perpetrators often go back to the scene of the crime. But since you lived there, in your case, it'd be difficult not to. But going back to check up on your victim...
He's not my victim!
Lots of criminals do it, Lester. Some of them even go to the funerals of the victims. Mingle in with the mourners, leading sickos.
Look, this has got nothing to do with me.
You're starting to get right on my tits, Lester.
Well, just let me go, then.
No chance. We're going upstairs, sunshine. I'm charging you with attempted murder.
Telling.
What's all this frivolity?
Women's talk, Elder.
Must be slimming on men.
Handsome men, actually. You can't see many of them round here. Present company accepted, of course.
Of course.
I don't know how you manage to stay looking so slim, girl.
Well, I get up each morning and squeeze myself into my lycra. And then begin my exercises. Slowly at first, and then I steadily work myself up until my heart is pounding.
That must be a sight.
And then there's food, which I find sensual. Mangoes, passion fruit.
I like passion fruit.
If music be the food of love.
Play on! Right. Thanks. Okay, bye. Sorted. Hazel's had a word with the duty solicitor. He's on his way down there now.
So you couldn't charm her into doing it personally then?
Look, she's a good barrister. And if she can get Lester out of trouble, she'll be everyone's favourite lawyer.
If she can get Lester out of this, she'll be a bloody miracle worker.
All right there, Mum?
Yes, I think so. I'm happy that Jonathan's home.
Looks like Pearl is as well.
I know he needs a woman, but I'm not sure about Pearl. She's too old for him.
She's also a bit fast.
I hope he will stay.
Yeah. I missed him when he went away to Leeds. No more big bro to fight me battles for me at school.
Well, he's back now.
Yeah. But what is there to keep him here?
The church. Despite he and his father's differences, he's still the best one to take over.
We'll see.
Someone just threw a bucket of water on those two. I think it would turn to steam. In our days, such things are done in private. These Peters boys, no shame.
No shame,
no.
Ah, Jonathan.
Hiya. How are my favourite sisters?
Very pleased to see you. Aren't we just saying that he's the best man to take over the church?
Yes, because you've got a presence.
Charisma!
Jonathan.
Excuse me, ladies.
Ah, Jonathan, we should talk.
Sure, I won't be a minute.
Well, now, sisters, how you doing?
Fine.
Thank you. We thought you would have said a few words today.
I'll have a word with Sister Peters. It will be good to pray.
You spoke well at the funeral. Move the spirit to hear your words.
Well, if the Lord wishes it, I'll be doing a lot more preaching at Holy Trinity.
You will be?
Yes. Pastor Peters is hard to follow, but as his deputy, there is a certain natural feel to being his successor.
Mm-hmm.
And might I add, sisters, I do have plans for you two in the church.
For us?
Well, certainly the church needs wholesome people like yourselves. Honest, trustworthy.
Sister, didn't we just say that he's the perfect person to take over? Didn't we, Naomi?
We sure did.
These are the things your father left you. Jonathan, this was special to your father.
Thanks, Mum.
Aquila?
Yeah?
He and I wanted you to have this.
His ring?
Yes.
Mum, I don't want to sound ungrateful.
Those are your father's wishes.
But the pocket watch.
I'm sorry.
I don't understand.
Forget it.
Can't believe it. I used to sit on Dad's knee every night when he came home from work, and he'd let me wind up the watch for him. He taught me to tell the time by that watch.
Well, maybe you didn't realise it meant so much to you.
He said his special girl will get that watch.
Look, Dad had his funny ways, and we didn't always understand them. So why should now be any different? Come on, it's not the end of the world.
You don't change, do you? You just breeze back. Do you realise how hard it's been whilst you've been getting on with your own life? The funeral arrangements, keeping Mum going, sorting out Lester's problems?
Well, I'm working on that one.
What about the rest?
I'm not going to keep on apologising, Aquila. It begins to sound a bit insincere, do you know what I mean?
You sounded insincere the first time. Though, of course, Mum swallowed your excuses hook, line and sinker.
I told you, we were rerouted to Hamburg.
I thought it was Amsterdam.
Well, you know Mum.
Yeah. And you know all her soft spots too, don't you?
Hi. You busy?
No, I was just on my way downstairs.
Not got time for...
I don't think so.
You didn't hear what I had to say. But it can wait.
He's got his own mind.
You are staying around, aren't you, Jonathan?
You know I've got things to do, Mum.
The church has to have a leader. You know who that should be.
Elder Gittins is Dad's deputy. He's the natural successor.
Why? Why should he?
Because he just knows his score, that's all.
It needs a man of more... You've got more in you than him. He'll always be second in command.
Why does it have to be a man anyway?
You're not suggesting Sister Gittins, are you?
No. Me.
You? Hello? Hazel? I'm fine, thanks. Listen, it's Lester.
This is serious, Aquila.
So am I. There's nothing saying I can't be the leader of the church.
You are the secretary of the choir. You can lead it, maybe one day run it.
I don't want to just run the choir. Okay, I want to take over the running of the church.
Can we just forget this for a minute? That was Hazel on the phone. She's got a solicitor on his way down there now. Actually, it's Richard from your choir. But she suggests we take someone from the church down there with us.
Oh, well, I suppose that had better be one of the men then.
Okay,
Okay, it's up to Curtis's and then yours, yeah?
I'll think about it. Excuse me, is it 24 Lidby Street?
Yeah. Are you after?
Have I asked you about your business?
It's only asking.
I'm going to make myself a cup of tea, no? Well, I can make myself a pot or a cup. It's up to me. Nobody's telling me what to do. If I want to make a cup, I can make it. If I want to make a pot, I can do that as well. I'm in charge. You see, my name is Austin Sinclair Mantell, Vivian Augustus Herbert, Leroy Smith. Nobody's telling me what to do. Oh! They can't even tell me what to watch on television. No, they have something on there. They call it blouse and skirts. I tell you, it's people taking off the clothes. I'm not watching it. Oh, no, I'm not watching it.
Hello and good evening to Blouse and Skirt. I'm Tony Morris and this is the show that gives you all the talk about love, life, politics, sex, the whole nine yards. Firstly, on my left, Mr. Curtis Walker.
Evening, evening. All right.
A woman who needs no introductions, Gina Yashere. On my left, the brilliant Felicity Ethnic. And John Simmet. Thank you. First up on Blouse and Skirt, it is Q&A time. Question and answer. Every week we will take questions from you and we will try to give you answers which are relatively sensible. We'll wait and see. Let's take the first question from the lady in the red at the back there, please.
Should parents keep the right to discipline their children?
Should parents have the right to discipline their children? Right, okay. Ooh, I don't know. Curtis?
Yes, well asked. You sound like you're really interested. I think parents should have the right. And I think the law, I don't know when this law came in, because when I was growing up, I didn't know nothing about this law. All with Esther Rance and child. You try as a black child to make it to the phone, for phone Esther. You lose a hand, it's gone. And you got kids now taking their parents to court, European court, my dear. Who in the hell knew where the European court was? Daddy, I'm going to take you to the European court. What? Make it to the door. What? I think you should beat the children. Not beat them, people get trippy and, you know, lose it. See, if you've got any answer intelligence, you will never have to strike a child. If you're ignorant, you will have to lick them. All right? All right. But you can't talk to children. You can't. So don't do it. You said don't.
Gina.
Of course they have to, man. My mum always walked with a machete.
This is another Nigerian thing, isn't it?
Nigerian family, see, because discipline in my family was very harsh. There were 10 of us originally, down to 5 now. You know, come on, there's a big difference between black and white discipline, isn't there? Because white parents, they send the kids to Coventry for a couple of hours, isn't it? Go to your room. My mum would send me to Nigeria for a couple of years. come back and improve child. Gina, come downstairs and turn the TV to channel 4.
In the Caribbean, right, parents have the rights to everything. You know what I mean? Cause right now, unless children are paying bills, they have no rights at all. I'm just telling you, in the Caribbean, child lying is something children write with a pencil.
Well, I don't know, I had a good relationship with my parents. I just sort of basically told them, my business is my business.
And what did they say?
Well, my mum came to a compromise. She beat me, she beat me, she beat me. She beat me till I had to retrace my tracks and find where I lost my mind.
We live in a three-story house. We used to live in a three-story house in Brixton. My room was at the top of the house. My father could be in the kitchen at the bottom of the house and call me. Now, my father only call you once. If him call you twice, you're dead. Curtis! Oh, you're lucky. Now, that's control!
Next question. Lady there in the grey.
Have the royal family become a laughing stock?
Does that answer your question?
No.
OK. Curtis.
The royal family have become a laughing stock because I think they've lasted themselves. They should have gone. Done. You know, it's like they're trying to hold on to this empire, ruling the waves, ruling this. It's over. Let it go. You don't rule nothing no more. You can't rule your family.
Okay.
You know, I think it's nice if they move on and the Queen come like an agony on Good Morning Britain or something like that.
Or like, it'd be like Dear Queenie.
Yeah, Dear Queenie.
Dear Queenie.
Dear Queen.
Queen me leg
what do you do to clean a 25,000 bedroom house? Yeah. I'm having trouble with mine. You know, things like that.
Felicity?
My mother always say you pick, pick until you pick shit. No, they never want cool star play kid in the movie for Andrew. No? Them fine Fergie. Better class of Trollope.
The other thing I can't understand is, English people always want to see their leader, the royal family, naked. I can't understand that. They always want to see pictures of the royal family naked. Eh? I does not want to see my leader naked, right? I does not want to see Mandela without his clothes on, right? When Mandela was elected president, I did not think, I wonder what he looked like naked.
You must have heard about the Queen bailing out Fergie from her debts and all that. Now, you know that wouldn't have happened if the Queen was a black woman, innit? It would have been different. It'd be like, Fergie, I'm going to bail you out. I'm going to give you a little £10 loan. And I'm going to set you up in a little council flat in Hackney. Two bedroom. Now, go along.
So I have to disagree because they're not a laughing stock because them have money, right? And when you have money, it kind of helps because Princess Diana's saying she's had a terrible time with all these men sleeping with and revealing. I'll tell you something, right? She got 17 million from Prince Charles, right? All right, that's the divorce settlement. Laughing stock. I would sleep with Prince Charles for 17 million. And then go on, go on. Yeah.
Right, son, right.
Exactly. Then drive off in the car and come past the massive man and show fire again.
And we are moving on to talk about this week's stereotype, which is that marvellous, brilliant, well-known jumper company. And so they've decided to have a white mare being mounted by a black stallion. Isn't that nice and subtle?
It's disgusting. But advertising uses that all the time, advertisements, you know, black and white. On the personal things, they do black dirty. And then watch the thing and the black just disappears. It's all white and wonderful again. Oh, I feel so clean. I'm white and we're white. But that's not the reality, and I think we know that. But subconsciously, we kind of take all them things in. The black stallion on a wild male. What? What it mean? You said anything about jumper in there?
Listen.
Jumper. I am in agreement.
Jumper. Jumper. Oh, she's fable. Sure.
No, I'm in agreement with Curtis. I don't care about two horse want to have sex on TV. Not even in a advertisement. All I care about is the man that want to sleep with me.
Do you think that these advertising companies have got something to answer? They do this stuff all the time, don't they?
Black people should stop buying Benetton. They're taking the piss out to us. Right. You see the little picture with the little black girl and the devil and the little white blonde angel? Rubbish.
Right then, next up on Blouse and Skirt, it's that time when we have a little look at the moral maze. It's the dilemma, the dread dilemma of the week. And this week we're going to Bel Air.
Oh my God, a little rollerblade.
Remember when we went roller skating down in Venice?
That's when we first kissed. Derek, this is so sweet. I can't believe you did this.
You know, we've had a lot of firsts together.
I know.
You know, Ashley, there's another first I think we should do together.
Really? What?
Well, I love you, Ashley, and I think we should make love.
Oh, Ashley, don't fall for them lies. Yes, indeed, he wants you so badly. We guys never change those lines, you know. Curtis?
What?
Don't try and pretend. Come on.
She should not sleep with him. She's a young woman. Kick him out of the house. He's cheeky. Coming at the parents' house, come tell about him love and must do the loving things. No. And she's so sweet as well. Leave, go on, leave, keep your virginity intact. Yes. I know I have.
Guys, when you know you're on a promise, yeah, you know, and your lady says, you know, it's going to be on, and for the other kind of men, your man says it's going to be on, you know, I don't know. And you know, the evening starts off nice, you know, that candlelit dinner, you know, and then when you, you know, afterwards you go and wash, because you're not nasty, you know. You're sending her to wash, because you're not that nasty woman, you know. And then, you know, you're in the bed and you're kissing and stuff, and then all of a sudden she turns on the light and says, look, darling, we have to talk. I hate that. I say, why can't we talk afterwards, you know? I promise not to fall asleep, just talk afterwards.
Listen.
Well, it just goes to show, doesn't it? Men will bribe you, buy you little gifts. Tutus, them tell you how much them love you. Them free with that, you know, very free with that. I love you. Just roll off them tongue, I love you. Just to get you into bed. And when them take your things, do they want to know you? No, they don't want to know you. No! When they take your things, they won't take your sister things, then they won't take your mother things, and then they won't take everybody things. Just say no! Practice! Get me upset now.
Gina.
Now, Felicity is right, man. He's a liar. Don't believe them.
And a thief, innit?
Don't believe them until he gets you to the altar. Then you can believe what he's saying. Because I like an honest man. I want a man who'll come up to me and say, Gina, I don't want a long-term relationship with you. I just want you for sex. And I'll say, at last, I met an honest man. A man who can stand and tell the truth. A man who's in touch with his own feelings. A man who can stand strong in the face of adversity. Then I'd say, piss off, you filthy bastard.
So, John, men are liars, cheats, they steal, they say anything to get inside a woman's pants, because they like to wear them, maybe. John?
No, that's very true. I'm with your sisters. I know outside my bread's buttered. Let me just say one thing, though. She shouldn't sleep with him because he asked her to, OK? And unless you have a voice like Barry White, you don't ask anybody to sleep with you. Why do you think black men never ask for a dance in the dance hall? You try and create a rapport, you know what I mean? And then get in, that's what he should have done.
Because what's your
rapport,
John?
My rapport?
Oh, gosh!
It's because I like this
a answer. Demonstration.
Come now.
Okay, we go to the disco. I'm sitting there and having my drink. Bob Marley comes on. Now, don't get me wrong. I love Bob Marley. I do. But don't you find when you're the only black person in the room, right, and Bob Marley or Calypso song come on, you turn to the entertainment. Okay? You turn to the entertainment. Now, I'm sitting there, and all of a sudden, this guy comes over to me. Lorraine, playing your tune. Bob Marley. Buffalo Soldier. Come on, you only want to dance. Come on, dance. What do you mean you don't want to dance? Why not? I can limbo, you know.
I can even boogle.
It's why. Why does somebody do this? Why does somebody do that? The questions that plague you at night. And why has Whitney Houston, beautiful, talented, sexy, rich, married Bobby Brown?
Well, I think she married him because he sucked nipple good.
And you...
Bush, why don't you?
And you have... No. And you have evidence of this because...
Because it happened to me.
You and Bobby Brown had a little tink.
Yes, he did. Lick and suck. And it was bloody lovely. And she married him and I lost out. But I got some money.
A flight of fantasy there on Blouse and Skirt. Curtis. Curtis. Yes. Hello.
Yes. What it is, it goes back to the old thing, you know. Women say they want a nice, kind, decent guy, all right? And then when he approaches them, the first thing they ask him, have you got any children? He said, no, I haven't got any children. They ask him, are you with any? I ain't with him. He's a decent guy. Whitney used to go to church, you know. Church. And you know how much man did want her in the church? But she said, no. And she ended up with the roughest, rawest kind of man she could have had. And she wanted the higher. So when it mash up, get back together, mash up, she got nobody to blame but herself. And I wish them luck, because they're still together now, all right?
No, they're not.
Yes, they are.
Gina?
They're back.
Well, all I got to say...
Go on, Gina.
All I got to say, what choice has she had out of all the rich black men in Hollywood? Denzel taken. Now, all you had was, what, Stedman?
Yeah, because he's not taken,
right?
Is he?
And Michael Jackson. Oh, sorry, I said black men, didn't I? Stedman, just Stedman. No contest. Bobby, the little roughneck, a little bit rough and tumble, lick and suck.
Why does she like the rough? Let's ask this one question. Why is it that a woman like that would want to go for the rough, though? Why?
Because it's the same thing why women want to go for Shabba Ranks, and you don't get no rougher than that.
The thing I can't stand is my friends, I like to phone me up for advice but don't like to take it. Don't you hate that, ladies? Your friends phone you up and they're like, guess what? He's done it again. And you're like, what's he done? Well, we keep fighting. Well, I don't hit him, he just hits me. But it's my fault, I provoke him. I ask some stupid things like, where you been for the last 6 months? And you know, you say, listen, the guy is no good, leave him. What does she say? You're jealous. Because you haven't got a man.
Next question. From the lady there in the waistcoat.
Does the panel agree that the modern British man is a wimp?
It's a hard one. Well, yes, I think so.
Why?
But it's all right, though, because I can handle them, you know, because I know how to get rid of a useless one. Because my mum brought me up with pride. You know the kind of pride that loses you husbands? Pride! Because I'll get rid of a wimp. I'll be like, get out! I know it's your house.
If a black woman calls you a Frank Bruno of the bedroom, this is not a compliment. It means you look strong. You bang hard. But you can't last the distance.
Curtis.
Yes.
Is it in the food?
It's not in the... I don't know about that, but it's the women. The women have made the men the way they want them, and now they've made them that way, they're not happy. They're wimpy. They want the
Please.
Man to cut their toenail and do it. He's such a wimp, but he's my wimp. You know?
What's better? What is better than a nice Jamaican man? Oh, a nice so Nigerian. Chill, you down on your back and tell you, you think it ever goes away, and I'm here to me.
It was only a matter of time.
That's right, sisters everywhere, tell me you!
It's been reduced to smut once again.
They didn't show black people really making love in the shower. And it's not because we're not adventurous. It's not. It's just that black women, we don't like to get our hair wet, do we? Like, yo, watch the weave! There'll be no shower scene without a Sainsbury's carrier bag.
this part of the programme, we say, dream on. Imagine you were king. Imagine you were queen. Imagine you bathed in ass's milk and you were in charge. And if you were in charge, I always bathe in ass's milk, and if you were in charge, what would you do about this?
Ian Greer has always and continues to deny that he's ever paid MPs to ask questions. But his spokesman also confirmed rumours that he had made contributions averaging £500 into the 1987 general election fighting funds of a total of 25 MPs, 21 Conservatives, 2 Labour and 2 Liberal Democrats. The cash, he said, was raised by Mr Greer, but the contributors didn't know who the recipients were to be, nor did the recipients know who had contributed.
Yes, indeed, more sleaze for those marvellous Tories. Once again, cash for questions. If you were in charge of this country, how would you stop all the sleaze that these MPs seem to get up to?
I would have taken cash to ask them questions, but the kind of questions I would have been asking, they wouldn't have wanted to hear. So, you know, like, how come so many of Conservative MPs are being found dead with plastic bag over their head and oranges in their mouths? Why? And the most important question to me was, why was my gyro late on Friday? Why?
Felicity?
Well, somebody give me a £5 for raise the question. And when is a sister going to be at number 10 Downing Street? Diana. We can do things in there, you know.
Oh, what?
Yes, we can cook curry patties. How many could dance on a Saturday night to pay the electricity bill? And we can rent out the rest to the homeless.
John?
Yes?
John. I wouldn't do anything to him, actually, for that sort of crime. As long as he's paying me enough money, I'd keep it to myself. You know what I mean? Basically.
Seriously, you don't think that's a problem, that this guy's being paid all that money to ask questions?
It's a problem that he's not paying anything to me just now, but if I get some of it, him is cool, you understand me?
Curtis, fine.
No, I think it's indicative of the... Indicative.
Dictionary swallow.
Fancy in school, here we go. All right. Now, what it is, right, is the political setup over it is stupid. The rich get richer, and the poor don't have nothing. Because we want some questions asked, but we can't afford to slip a man out. Ask this question when you get here, all right? Ask why them throws in the bloody school. Ask why them throws in the children's school, though. I want to know why. There's no, and all them, see them ramps? You see them humps they're doing on the road, sleeping policemen? It's not needed, no. But them public backhander and the man who owned the contractor for put on the humps is an MP. He's a living MP, and they put the humps there, put police everywhere that they don't need them. They don't need them, and the money's going to the rich people. The rich people are spending more than they need, and we broke no rats to have nothing.
Yes, Curtis the President, we say. That's it for tonight. My thanks to my guests once again. Curtis Walker. Jeannie Yashere. Felicity Ethnic. And John Simmet. That's it. Yes, indeed. We'll be back same time next week. From me, Tony Morris, good night.
Home to real people.
This is the day, look. Nighttime's a bit heavier.
With jobs to hold down.
Very miserable indeed. I have got 4 million shirts to iron.
Appearances to keep up.
The Wonder Bra. Best design of the decade.
News to keep abreast of.
Buckingham Palace is full of Germans.
Meet the girls. And the boys.
Oh!
Of Soho.
They do believe that they're living in a soap opera.
Soho Stories. Stories to stay up for every Monday, Tuesday and Wednesday, starting this Monday at 11:15 on BBC Two.
Ah! I think I might have some action for you.
She's got it. He's got it. They've all got it. And you can get it too.
Excellent.
Watch BBC Two weekdays from 6 for guaranteed 6 appeal.
Yeah.
This is the BBC. Let's get it on.
Sure.
yes, you know, the world is full of criminals. You don't know who they are. Some of them, I mean, like even this fella there, you see, he's running away from something there. I mean, he's a thief. He's got something in his pocket. He stole it from somebody. You see, the world is full of criminals all over the place, you know. I don't let nobody come inside my house. I even let them come inside my house. I make sure when they're leaving, I put my hand in their pocket to see what they're trying to thief from me. Yes, I mean, all these celebrities letting people come inside the house and hang time. I mean, they're going to thief your things.
Hi, welcome to another edition of Hang Time. This is part of the A-Force, where we get behind the public image of the world's biggest stars. I'm Fiona Nierenjohn, and this week, all you football fans, eat your heart out, because I'm here in Milan, Italy, home of some of the world's best football players, like Roberto Baggio, Paolo Maldini, and of course, the governor, Paul Ince. But I'm going to go a cut above even these. Instead, I'm going to be hanging out with the greatest footballer on the planet, the FIFA World Player of the Year, the African Player of the Year, and the European Player of the Year, and scorer of one of the wickedest goals ever. Yes, the one and only George Weah. Now, we all know about his mesmerising runs on the football pitch, but does he run a tidy home? Well, stick around for this and more juicy secrets as we spend some hang time with football god George Weah, who's around here somewhere. All I see is Babylon and Rome. You know, it's taken me an hour to find this place, and I finally got in past the security gates of Milan AC Football Training Ground. I'm waiting for George Weah, you know, the super goal man. Albertini, still not George. Hey, there he is, it's training. Oh well, looks like we're just gonna have to wait for him, doesn't it? That's it, George. Oh, there he is. George, hi. I'm Fiona. Can we go to
your home? Yeah, no problem. Let's go.
Yeah, sure, go. Can I keep this?
Yeah, keep that.
Okay, let's go. So, how are you? As well as the individual accolades of World and European Player of the Year, George's brilliance has been earning him awards throughout his career. He's won a French Cup with Monaco, two more French Cups, and a league title with Paris Saint-Germain, and an Italian championship with AC Milan. So, this is the house of George Weah.
Welcome.
Thank you.
May I have your coat, please?
Oh, right, well, thank you. Thank you very much. That's very kind of you.
You look nice without the coat.
I look nice without the coat?
Yeah.
All right.
This session is for it's for my wife. I'm very messy, so she don't like for me to come around this area.
Go and sit there then.
Yeah, because when I'm around, I put everything on the floor. I will take off my shoes, my clothes, I get chunked them down. You know, so but I try to respect this area because I think it's good because this is where we receive people when they come to visit us, you know. It's more private, more easy in there and yeah.
How do you cope with the press?
I'm a very simple man. Even in Africa, I try to limit too much talk into the press. Yeah. You know, sometimes the press thing, I just want to be, you know, stubborn. But I like the press. But every day, I don't like to talk because it's not possible that somebody says something every day. I only speak when it's necessary because I don't like to talk too much.
Aha! Wow, George, this is amazing. Look how many CDs you've got. Can you actually remember the first one you bought?
Michael Jackson was my first CD that I bought.
Did you do the dancing to it? Good.
MJ, you know, he always like this. Yeah, well, he's a great entertainer. We love him.
Who's this? Who's this? Let me go around here.
Yeah.
This one?
This is my dad. This is Mr. Weah. Mr. Weah Senior.
The footballer that you followed?
Yeah. He used to love music, he used to love football, you know. And then, yeah.
So, I mean, your dad obviously was a footballer. He was a great influence to you. What else did you sort of get from him?
He's my dad and my daddy used to play football before. I took the role of my daddy. For most of the poor African countries, like Liberia and other African countries, we believe in Bob Marley because we that grew up from the ghetto. I came from the ghetto of Gibraltar in Monrovia. We listened to Bob Marley music and it inspired us, you know, how to be strong, how to go through life. Life is a long way, it's very difficult, you know, you have to be very strong, you know. You got to go and look for it yourself, nobody can bring it to you. And then I believe in the Rastafarian philosopher, you know.
Basically,
we've got to salute Bob. Yeah, Imperial Majesty, Alicias here the first. King of King, Lord of Lord, conquer in the land of child of Judah, Rastafari. For Africa, I'm from Africa. African leaders fight for Africa. Freedom fighters fight for Africa. My mother Africa, we really need to be free. It's only unity what we want. You know, don't allow some of us together.
George met his wife Claire on one of his many trips to New York, where he has another home and several business interests. George's home, Liberia, and the U.S. have always had close links, as Liberia was founded by freed American slaves.
No, George is actually a very soft and kind person. I guess you probably can't see that when he's on the field because, like you say, he's very aggressive and very tough. That's why I'm with George, because he's a nice person. And apart from his life outside with the fans and the cameras and the journalists, I like being at home with him. We go on the street, people just bombed us for autographs, pictures, everything. He's always away traveling when it's not with Milan, it's the national team. So we enjoy our time at home with him and the children.
George, you're so sweet.
Yeah, you're making me shy now.
This is George Weah, shy? I don't think so.
Four, five. Okay.
See that?
Say, for example, you could go back, all right, and
yep.
Do it all over again. Would you change anything?
I mean, doing it over again?
Not the food.
The
career.
Oh, my career? Yeah. You know, whether God knows, you know, we always hoping for the best. And,
Smells good.
Yeah, it smells good. We need protein, you know. We need to be really physically fit when we're playing.
You eat a lot. I should ask your wife this question, yeah. Shouldn't I?
Yeah, I eat a lot, you know. Yeah, because I work hard and I always want to eat. I eat almost 2 a.m. in the morning. Yeah, I have no limit. I just eat and eat and eat. I eat maybe five times a day. If I don't have food to eat, I eat cornflakes at midnight before I sleep. And it's very important because I work hard and I'm always hungry.
George's kids clearly know when something's cooking. And his son Champ, daughter Martha and niece Jessica all rush the kitchen come feeding time.
Does he cook good?
Yeah.
Yeah?
I have to taste my food, or are you?
Okay.
Ah. It's nice.
Nice.
Yeah.
Is he a good cook?
No, he is, but he doesn't like to cook when I'm here. But if I'm not here, like I told you before, he cooks, and he cooks for the children also.
Don't forget your food.
No, I know. You know, I tell me.
Oh, so, you're timing it?
Yeah, you got 35 seconds to go.
Talk us through that goal. What was going through your mind and your feet?
I took the decision that I was going to go, and no matter what, I'm going to go. But the situation I was in, I was afraid, first of all, to lose the ball. But if I lose the ball, it's very bad for us. And luckily for me, I did some little tricks. One of the most important, the finishing, you know, to get the ball in the net.
What was your first reaction?
You saw my reaction, crazy. Because I went to somebody that I don't even know. You saw me hugging somebody in the crowd. I don't know the man from nowhere. I just went to him, just like this on him, you know. But, you know, sometimes the goals we score. We score a lot of good goals. Mm. But as the situation appears, you do things that you don't even know. People appreciate me for what I do.
George's African pride even led him to dip into his own pocket and meet the considerable financial cost, including airfares and hotel bills, of putting the war-torn and impoverished Liberia into the African Nations Cup.
Well, for me, it's like I'm the same old person, you know? Nobody knows the future, but we always hope for the best, and I pray God that up to the time I have my contract, everything goes smooth and go well. Voila, to show you I'm a good cook.
Hey guys, wish me luck.
Good luck.
No, it won't kill you.
Mmm, George, I won't tell anyone that you can cook, okay?
Won't tell them.
But that is really good. So what have we looked at? You've got the footballer, which we all knew about, the musician, the cook. Hey, what can I say? I'm out of here.
You miss one thing. And the family man.
Oh, and the family man.
Yeah, okay.
The A-Force on BBC Two.
Yes, star, let me tell you something now. Hollywood done, you know. Everything now coming from yard. Denzel Washington, move over. You ever hear of Vibert Duffus? Yes, star. Wesley Snipes? Over. You ever hear of Glenroy Archibald? He's the Don now. Yes, star. Even the movie, them, they change up the name. You know that thing they used to call it now, Batman and Robin? No, it's called Lizard Man and Sparrow. Yes, star. And that thing they used to call Mission Impossible? No, it's called... Why? You can't do that. Yes, star. You know the other one they call it Phenomenon? No, them calling it... But wait. What the rass are going here? Yes. So. But listen now, if you want check video clip, check for the 411. All right then.
Hey, I'm Mark Tondorai, and this is What's the 411. And I'm here to tell you, if it's blown up in the black entertainment world, then this is the place to check it.
On tonight's program, we're going to be checking out Morgan Freeman in his latest film, Chain Reaction. And if that isn't enough, then be sure to check out the music videos. And we're going to be dishing the dirt on the celebrities. Plus, there's a special feature on Mr. Love Daddy, Mr. Love Machine himself, Babyface.
Here's the flavor in your ears with my selector.
Come down, my selector.
It's going down, fade to Black Street. The homies got at me, collab creations. Bump like agony, no doubt. I put it down, never slouch. As long as my credit can vouch, a dog couldn't catch me. Tell me who could stop with Dre making moves, attracting honeys like a magnet, giving them orgasms with my mellow accent. Still moving this flavor with the homies Black Street and Teddy, the original Rough Shakers.
Shutting it down, good lord. Baby got them open all over town. Strictly bitch, you don't play around. Cover much grounds, got game by the town. Getting paid is a forte. Each and every day, true play away. I can't get her out of my mind. I think about the girl all the time. East side to the west side, pushing fat rides, it's no surprise. She got tricks in the stash, stacking up the cash, fast when it comes to the gas. By no means average, it's on when she's got to have it. Baby, you're a perfect 10, I wanna get in. Can I get down so I can? I like the way you work it.
No diggity.
I got to bag it up.
Bag it up.
I like the way you work it.
No diggity.
I got to bag it up.
Bag it up.
I like the way you work it.
No diggity.
I got to bag it up.
Bag it up.
I like the way you work it.
No diggity.
I got to bag it up.
What's the 411?
On The Real Deal tonight, we check out Morgan Freeman in his latest film, Chain Reaction.
The Real Deal.
Morgan Freeman always gets cast with other big-name stars, who receive a lot more cash than he does and also a lot more media attention. But then, as soon as the credits roll, yeah, who gets center stage? Morgan does. Why? Because he's a bad actor. In Seven, Brad Pitt got his ass firmly kicked by Morgan's performance, and in Chain Reaction, it's Keanu Reeves' turn to pucker up.
What money? The $250,000 the FBI found in your loft.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Morgan plays a mysterious university benefactor whose favorite research project gets sabotaged. Suddenly, the research team is on the run from the police and the saboteurs. Crippin? Check it out.
Every idea that offers a competitive advantage to Americans is subject to theft, and that gentleman could be catastrophic.
There is enough energy in this glass of water to power the city of Chicago for weeks.
You'd be interested in this technology.
Cheap, clean, abundant energy. For what?
What sets the film in motion is this man, the scientist, who discovers this clean, inexpensive energy source, wants to give it away for free. Can't do that.
Action thriller, hopefully with some interesting characters.
So that was Chain Reaction. There are massive gaping holes in the plot, but as ever, reliable Morgan Freeman saves the day. I don't know what it is about this man, but he can really act. He creates his character that is kind of like good or bad. I don't know, you don't know right until the end what he is, but he's brilliant. When you watch Morgan, you think, boy, acting is easy. Then you see Keanu, and then you're reminded, of course, that it isn't. Right, my selector. More music.
Come down, my selector.
Great, I'm in trouble, I suppose, because I just hit girlfriend Jalopy in my drop-top rolls. Traffic came to a halt. I'm like, I beg your pardon, madam, it was totally my fault. And instead of a yelling and acting all butt-hunt, all in my drop-dead gorgeous mug. Pretty, body definitely curvy. And thirdly, the way she dyed her hair bronze fitted her superbly.
Baby, let me say what's on my mind. Take a little time to express myself. Honey, I think you're fly. Now I don't have no problem saying what I like. I'd like to spend some time with you, starting with tonight. And I like the way you walk, the sexy way you talk. Ooh, I can't help myself, baby, I like to kiss your lips. And when you move your hips, ooh, I can't help myself, baby, I like. Here's the situation, I lay it on the line. Meaningless relationship.
baby, we got nowhere to go.
What's the 411?
You want to know what's going on in black entertainment? Who's doing what? Who's dealing with who? Who's playing who? Well, the lowdown is for you. Here's your weekly fix. Here it comes.
The lowdown.
Fujimania continues to spread. Two number ones in a row, sellout dates, and now they've raked in the most amount of nominations for the 1996 MTV Europe Music Awards. The nods include Best Group, Best Breakthrough Artist, Best Song, and some new category called MTV Amore. Even though he's dead, he still remains a talking point. His new video was biked over to MTV America by Death Row Records the day after he died. Boy, they didn't waste any time. And it eerily features him dying and going to heaven. Art mirroring life, huh?
Now we was once two brothers of the same kind, quick to approach a ghetto cutie with the same line. You was just a little smaller, but you still roll. Got stretched away.
An album, Machiavelli, is scheduled to hit the stores November 12th, setting up an interesting showdown with Snoop's album, The Dogfather, which is released November the 5th. Spike Lee's new film, Get on the Bus, was funded by Black Money. Originally, Columbia Pictures offered to fund the movie, which is about 15 men taking a bus from LA to the Million Man March in Washington. But Spike Lee rejected the money and raised it from black superstars like Will Smith, Wesley Snipes, and Danny Glover. Spike said that he wanted it that way so that the film could stay true to the march.
It's like sensory overload, this is. We've got some stuff for your eyes. That's movies. We've got some stuff for your mind. And now we've got some stuff for your ears. Here's the flavor in your ears with my selector.
Come down, my selector.
Peeps and we roll sheep, flying first class from New York City to Black Street. What you know about me? Now the I'm saying Cartier wooded frame sported by my shorty. As for me, icy gleaming pinky diamond ring. We bees to buy this click up on this scene. Ain't you getting bored with these fake boards? High shows improves, no doubt. I've been thinking so. Please excuse if I come across rude. That's just me, and that's how a player's got to be. Stay kicking game with a capital G. Ask the peoples on my block. I'm as real as can be. Word is born. Faking moves never been my thing. So Teddy, pass the word to Yoga and Chauncey. I'll be sending a call. Let's say around 3:30. Queen Pen
no
and Black.
No diggity, no doubt, baby.
I like the way you work it. No diggity, I got the bag.
Girl, I got it going on.
I like the way you work it.
No diggity, no diggity.
We out.
What's the 411?
Who loves you? Yeah, we do. We give you movies, we give you music, and now computer games.
Cyber talk.
There's a new game out, right? It's called Burning Road. It's a heap of fun, lots of light, and the graphics are just brilliant. Now, you can play it against the clock, or you can play in two-player mode, which means that you can play against your mom, your dad, your brother, and even your dog, if he likes that sort of thing. I dig racing games. You know when you're in a car? I love them.
Hey, come on,
get a grip. And Damon Hill is into the last chicane.
the 411.
On this week's Reality Checks, we feature a man that everybody knows, a man who probably everybody's bought his stuff. I mean, if you bought Tony Braxton, then you know this guy. If you bought the soundtrack to Boomerang, then you know this guy. We're talking about Babyface.
Reality Checks.
Everyone probably has some music that Babyface has touched. Everybody. You don't believe me? Okay. You got any Boyz II Men in your collection? Any TLC? Any Tony Braxton? When it comes to making hit records, this guy does it time after time. He's had 105 top 10 R&B hits, including 40 number ones. Name any music award. Yep, the boy's got it.
I just feel like I've been really lucky. You know, I've just been really, really blessed for everything to work out for me, because there's so many things that go into making a hit record, and it doesn't have all to do with the writer or the producer. It takes the writer, the producer, the artist, the record company, the radio stations, you know, the retail. It's so many things that and people that are involved in helping you make a hit. So you can't ever just look at it and say, I did that. It doesn't work that way. It's a lot of people involved. So I just have to look at it that everyone that's been involved with it, we've all been very blessed for it to happen for us. First single from the album is a song called This Is For The Lover In You, which is actually a remake of old Shalimar song, This Is For The Lover In You. I have LL Cool J, and actually the original members of Shalimar are on the song as well. And it's more of a hip-hop version of the song, I think. It's up-tempo, and where the other one was more of a ballad, this is a kind of an up-tempo record. So. It's a lot different, but it's pretty fun. It's just more of an up kind of a thing. Throw this rock up on your hand, I'll give you the world in your face. Woo! On the grill was the honey looking lace. Ooh, baby.
One night, drop top Bentley coupe parked in the spotlight, and you can drive it laced in all white. I'm wearing triple black, a gear's top flight. Trips to Venice, the man of steel when I'm in this. A match made in heaven when we blend this. Love is everlasting, in other words, endless. To love any other man would be senseless. Hey, your face. Ooh. On the grill was the honey looking laced.
Ooh, baby, baby, baby.
What's the 411?
Kaput, done, finished for another week. See you next week, where we're going to have more movies, more music, more games. You know the score. I'll see you then. Take care. Bye.
Yes, well, this is the cheeky monkey that I caught earlier. He's a fair dodger, you see? Now, what you do with them is you put the handcuff on them, and then you lock them onto the railings like so, you know? And then what you do is you bring him round here, and you say, well, what the hell you think you was playing that running across the road, and you know you never had no ticket, right? You meet Samuel Benjamin now, didn't you, eh? And then you get the baseball bat and you give him a crack over his skull, you know? Not hard, you know, just enough to concuss him a little bit and make him feel a little bit faint. And then you fall down, right? And then you get him on the ground like so. And you say, well, I'm sorry I had to do that. But you never had no ticket and he was running across the road. You meet Samuel Benjamin, no. That is your beginner's guide to catching a fair dodger.
Get on it, man.
No, you're gonna dig this.
Slavery and racism not only produced physical horrors, it left black people with a long-term legacy of mental and psychological illness. Mental slavery and inferiority complexes are the milder forms. Schizophrenia, the more serious. Even today in Britain, black people are overrepresented in mental institutions, with young men 10 times as likely as their white counterparts to be diagnosed as schizophrenics. In two famous books, Black Skin, White Masks, and The Wretched of the Earth, psychiatrist Frantz Fanon believed he could cure the world of this illness.
Yes, you will. I wanted to change the world, to eliminate racism, to get blacks to deal with their inferiority complex, and for whites to deal with their God complex.
And do you think that you've achieved this?
Yes, I helped change the world.
You're deluded. Nobody knows who you are.
That's not true. Everybody knows me.
Never heard of him.
Never heard of him.
I don't know who that is.
Yeah, tell me about Frantz Fanon.
Frantz Fanon was a brilliant black writer and psychiatrist from Martinique who joined the Algerian resistance. His best-known book, Wretched of the Earth, has become a kind of Bible for many contemporary revolutionary movements.
Fanon was concerned, it seems to me, with the fact that black people found themselves feeling inferior and reaching for a way out of that inferiority by imitating white people.
The disaster of a man of color lies in the fact that he was enslaved.
Fanon argued that racism undermined black confidence and self-belief. This frequently produced psychiatric confusion and mental instability. Occasionally, it led to outright madness.
Fanon used some of the case studies on which he worked as a psychiatrist in order to build up his body of evidence about how white people felt about black people and about the kind of effect that those ideas and ideologies had on black people themselves.
I went out and I looked up in the air and I seen a spaceship flashing a red light, and I noticed it because it stood one place hovering, you know, in the air. Well, it went on for some time. I thought more or less that must be what's causing me to hear these voices.
In a way, he was a decolonizing the mind before decolonizing the colony, so to speak. Yes, we have to act. There's something, because he was psychiatrist, there's something we have to do with the head, with the mind, that flips that out.
For the black man, there is only one destiny. It is white. Frantz Fanon, Black Skin, White Mask.
Long ago, the black man admitted the unarguable superiority of the white man, and all his efforts are aimed at a white existence. But I want him to liberate himself from the madness.
I don't think our destiny is to become white. I don't think we will become white. And it depends also how we kind of look at what he's saying, if we're actually going to perpetuate everything within white society, or if he's saying that we're going to become white on a literal basis.
And it's real, it's not in the imagination. It seems to me white people, at the point at which Fanon is writing, white people are in power. They're in political power, they're in economic power, yes, they're in cultural, historical power, they're running the show, yes. So it would be very weird if you were black in that situation, you were saying, well, we're superior, you know, it's very obvious, that's what the mirror is saying, mirror on the wall, it's telling you, you know, that the white person is what's happening.
Having studied the racism of Martinican and French society, by the 1950s, Fanon was ready to implement his ideas for treating the psychological damage inflicted on Algerians by their French colonial masters.
The struggle between the master and the slave is a struggle for power, partly for who possesses the products of the slave's labor.
As he moves through his life, he's developing his analysis, developing his politics and so on, he moves away from the individual predicament, yes, psychological predicament, to the way in which the individual psychology is going to be sprung by shifting the social. Yes, the broader political.
It is a question of the third world starting a new history of man, Frantz Fanon, the wretched of the earth.
Frantz Fanon had one of the most moving things in his book is the thing that determined him to make the break with the existence he had as a psychiatrist in a French hospital in Algeria. The experience was that a policeman came to him for treatment and explained that he had taken to tying up his wife and children and beating them systematically. So Fanon asked him what he did for a living, and he explained that this, in fact, was what he did for a living. He beat up people in the prison. So Fanon said to him, I can't cure you of beating up your wife and children when you go home, if you still go on doing this during the day.
Latterly, his work was of great importance to people involved in post-colonial struggles, or as was then, struggles for independence. The colonies, not only the French colonies, but British colonies, involved in the struggle for independence from Britain, from France.
We see that there's violence in the native quarter. His was the native quarter in the colony, yes. And the first violence is violence amongst themselves, what today people call crudely black-on-black violence. Yes? In the native quarter, there's lots of life is crude, it's brutal, it's violent. And Fanon's thesis was, well, of course, this is what happens because these people are violated, there's the violence there. In the end, he says, when they identify the correct enemy, they will focus the violence correctly, and this will be the means of their liberation. Yes, out of colonialism and out of that horrible heritage of humiliation.
Fanon's ideas were crucial and fundamental to black liberation movements during the 60s. His work was translated into English in the late 1950s and became available, and it was said that people in the Black Panther movement in particular referred to his works a great deal.
Oh, my body, make of me always a man who questions.
This new man is very much a man in Fanon's language, actually. It's concerned with dignity and pride and standing up and not being bent over and exercising control and so on.
He is guilty in the same way as numerous nationalists, so-called nationalist leaders, were guilty. If the whole idea about gaining nationalist power is for men, or for the nation, the people within the nation, to be on a par with white society, it is the case that many men do not see women as on a par with them.
Fanon's lasting legacy was to challenge black people to see themselves as individuals and not to define themselves by their colour.
It's interesting.
The Negro is not any more than the white man.
Fanon died in 1961 from leukemia while still at the peak of his powers. He left behind a body of ideas which became the foundation for black consciousness and self-determination.
Sad, isn't it? We gone. But don't cry, don't fret. Join us next week, same time, for more of
the A-Force.
Let's go.